How's everyone doing? Oh wait, not yet. Alright, now we'll do this. Alright, live, why are you lying to us? Am I live right now? I'm not lying. Come on, guys. Come on. So, how is everyone doing? Ezra Muller, when do we start Killing Mockingbird? Monday. We start Monday. You get the weekend off. How is everyone doing? What did everyone think of the book? Let's start very basic. Everyone should have finished by now. What are your thoughts? Did you love it? Did you hate it? Did you have weird feelings? Are you thinking about life differently now? Did you not care at all? Did you frankly think this book sucked? Like, what are your thoughts? That's what I'm curious. That's everyone's allowed to have a different opinion, and everyone should. Everyone's read it through the different prism of their own eyes. So it should be kind of fun. So good. Loved it. Okay, Nicole's 114, not much of a fan. All good. Loved it. I guarantee you, in the list of books that I have prepared, there will be at least one or two that I won't like myself. I'll be like, it's like the worst when you read a book and it feels like a chore, but sometimes you have to. Okay, started late. All right, good. I'm glad you're loving it. It's not my type of book. Totally loved it. Enjoyed it. Have weird feelings. Got confused a couple times. Charlotte Life 93, totally understand. Same. but I loved it. Weird feelings. And this time reading it, I've had a lot more questions. Liked it. Quick reading. All the emotions went through. What a journey. I agree with you. Loved it. Definitely seeing things differently. Interesting book. Liked it. Good morning. It was amazing. I like this book, but I didn't read it my first language, so I didn't understand everything. Oh, all good. Oh, you know what? I want to say congratulations to everyone that read this in a language other than their first language. Like, good for you guys. That's intense. That takes a lot of dedication and a lot of practice and a lot of whoa, sending you into a midlife crisis. Oh, don't let it do that. Book was amazing. I think I'll have to read it a few times to understand it properly. Catherine, I have to read it like 5 more times to really get it. But I love where I'm at with it now, and it's funny because it's changing every time I read it. So I actually have an announcement today. We have a special guest to join us. Person, also a member of the book club, who lives here in Boston. They called me like, Alberto, I think you're the coolest person in the world. I want to be on the book club. I want to be there and talk about the book. And I was like, I don't know. It's a pretty exclusive book club. You have to be like pretty. And he's like, I'm pretty awesome. So I was like, all right, you can join. Everyone say hi to the man, the myth, the legend.
Hello.
Diego Felipe. He will be joining us for our live session. I don't know. We're going to have to like, Diego and I will back up a little bit. There we go.
You want to tilt it down?
No, that's good.
Yeah, it's fine. I mean,
there's my phone.
So Diego's going to be talking about the book with us. Diego, first question, what were your thoughts?
I really enjoyed it. I thought the message was interesting. I thought it was very timely. Timely, I feel like. I think any book about war is timely almost, because I feel like we're always at war, but which is terrible.
It's
and
awful.
I think that's why we need books like this to challenge our thought process on a system that's kind of broken. So
I had one person message me, and I love the quote that they used here. Like, I'm quoting them. It was, I've never been so successfully convinced of pacifism.
Exactly.
Then after I read this book, and I was like, that's such a cool way to put it. The way Vonnegut structures that argument is very much like common sense. It just feels like anyone who thinks contrary to that is missing a few screws. And I think you can see that when Billy Pilgrim is in the hospital bed across from the other man, who seems to have it all figured out according to like what we consider success. But he still thinks of Billy, a different person, as something less than himself, which in Vonnegut's mind makes him an unsuccessful person, which I think is cool.
Mm-hmm.
There's that juxtaposition there. Yeah, I can read that far, Shirolo, don't worry. I can read the comments. Is Bernard V. O'Hare a character in Pilgrim's Story? He is, but he's not. like in the second, in one of the chapters when they're in Dresden, it is brought up actually multiple times when they're in the camp with the Brits and when they're in Dresden. Vonnegut weaves himself into the story and is like, the man that was saying he was shitting his brains out, that was me. And that one time we were all formed in ranks on the moon, I was there, Bernard V. O'Hare was there. Notice there's never really strong interactions with Billy. I think that's to keep Billy the protagonist and that being the main storyline. And then that is just to bring in the idea that, yeah, this is like semi-true. Like, a lot of these things did happen. And this is an experience that Vonnegut is giving through Billy, I think. And that's why he uses Billy's name a lot. Billy did this. Billy did that. Billy says. It's also to break, I think, the moments that are truthful and the moments that are from Billy's perception. Billy has become unstuck in time, he says. You know, all of those little things that make you aware that Billy's the one saying these things. Billy's the one making these assertions. Am I in Boston? I am in Boston. Sorry, I was talking, so I wasn't reading. Favorite part of the books. Let's see. Do you like Billy as a character?
No.
No, I don't.
Not at all.
I think Billy is the worst type of person.
Yeah, I think he's indecisive. I think he's a coward.
He has no drive.
Yeah, he has no drive to make any choices for himself. He doesn't want to. He doesn't even care to achieve anything for himself, I feel like. Even when you look at his wife, what's her name? The wife's name?
Valencia Marble?
Valencia. He married her because she was rich and no one else would marry her. He wanted money, easy money too. He also knew that he was going to get hooked up with an optometrist job just through that. So he kind of allowed his life to be given to him and to unroll before him rather than making decisions. And I think that all plays into the real theme of the novel as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
So
I just think that's such I don't know, I think it's so cool that he uses Billy Pilgrim as this like complete opposite of what a good soldier would be throughout the whole book.
Mm-hmm.
And has him survive the war. And they even say it, all the real soldiers are dead. And he's like, and she was right. They all were. So it goes.
Yeah.
Like, I thought that was super intense. Combined a real life horror story and something that was interesting to read. He's on autopilot his whole life. That's such
there
a good
go.
Comment. He's
That's
on autopilot.
A great way to
That's
say it.
Bianca Frank, that's freaking awesome. Yeah, and I think we all know people that are kind of on autopilot. They don't really make any decisions, but they keep kind of moving. Oh, this is what I was going to say. When you mentioned that, Billy was just like doing all the things that he knew a successful man should do, but he didn't want to do them.
Exactly.
And that bothered me a lot. I was like, this guy, he's getting lucky, and he's living a blessed life, and he's gotten to see it many times, so he's got to be like, oh, this is nice. But he's always jumping back and forth, so he never really experiences life. He's always looking at it in reverse. Or, I don't know. There's a thing about that, never being in the moment, that really freaks me out. Like,
yeah, I feel like what makes you who you are, your actions and your choices, and to an extent, Billy Pilgrim never made a choice, especially when it came to the war and stuff. Even he was like, oh, leave me here, when he was walking through the woods, and the people kept pulling him along. And he always just let the people pull him along.
And he always, even though he knew he was going to survive, he always let himself still say, leave me here, leave me here.
Exactly. So he was very much like a non-person in that extent, that he was just this body that was floating around.
A word he just said.
Yeah, a non-person.
A non-person, I love that.
Mm-hmm. He was just floating around, allowing the forces of nature and whatever else to push him in the direction.
He tried to make a decision on his own when he decided to tell the world about the aliens, but his daughter took that from him.
Well, I mean, all I know is he seemed pretty happy when he actually decided that he was going to tell the world about the aliens.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the happiest to me that he'd been in the whole book. So maybe that one choice.
But then
was
what did the world want him to do?
Direction.
The world wanted him to go back on autopilot. The world liked Billy better on autopilot. They didn't like Billy when he was breaking from the norm, telling them things that weren't inherently, that couldn't be proven. Like, time doesn't work that way. No, people don't want to hear that. People were like, nah, that's bull. What do you think? No, not so much.
I mean, I don't know. He was talking about Traffadorians and stuff. Traffadumorians. Traffamadorians. Let's see.
Traffamadorians. So, wait, let's talk about Traffamadorians. What do you guys think of them? When we enter chapter 5, I'm pretty sure. Give me a sec. Yeah, we enter chapter 5, and he's going to hang out with the Traffamadorians for the first time. Like, that's right after he gets kidnapped, abducted, and goes straight for it. So, what do you think about that? First, let's talk about the first image that they talk about as humans as millipedes. What do you guys think about humans as millipedes?
Humans as millipedes.
I just think that was cool. Like, the Chalfadorians don't see people as a two-legged person. They see them as a giant millipede with baby legs on one side and grown and like old people legs on the end.
You know what that's very similar to is kind of like, I don't know if you guys have seen Interstellar, but when they're in the cataract and you get to see every level of time and you're literally seeing every single moment all the way up and all the way down, all being lived all at once. I feel like that's the way you can, like, Chalfadorians kind of see humans all at once, all together, one life, one big brick,
mm-hmm.
a brick of time, you know?
It's super cool.
Crazy.
I just thought, I just couldn't, like, when I read that, I actually put the book down and I had to think about how would they move? Do they, if he sees them all, they see them move, so do they, what are they, I don't know. It's such an interesting concept. Like, I want to see the film now. I'm going to watch that soon, just so I can, because we've read it again. Takes a lot of people to reproduce, apparently. I thought that was weird. They think they're...
Yeah, 9 people to reproduce.
Yeah, 7 or something like that.
I thought what was really interesting was their version of books.
Yes,
I was... You see everything all pushed together at once in one perfect, beautiful, emotional moment where you're feeling many things all at once in this one moment. And I think that's a lot of the way life is.
I would say like a panorama
so
type thing. Like earlier, the life, they see life as like a giant panorama where they can go like this and it's all there.
Well, they see their time.
Like, yeah, their time.
Yeah.
But yeah, their books, they sound so cool. But at the same time, I don't think we would understand them. I don't think they follow the way we think.
I mean, to an extent. I think if we could somehow encapsulate all, like, it, one crazy moment of our life where we're feeling a bunch of emotions, but at the same time, it's all, like, so perfect.
But I think moments,
if
like...
If you can put it all into one thing, like, if you could just see it all at once, feel all of that, and be there all at once in one single moment. That's what they're doing, and that's cool, you know?
Yeah, but I think the moments structure the feeling. You know, like, we go moment to moment, like in film. A guy in a suit holding, like, and then you see him standing there in a suit, then you see him put his hand in his pocket, and he pulls out a ring.
Yeah, but you don't know what he's feeling, even at the beginning. You don't know why he's there.
Right,
imagine if you could see all that at once.
Yeah, but then you
switch.
But I feel like you need the moments to, like,
no, you don't, because if you can see all of time and stuff, you don't need that. You can go right to that moment and feel it, because you can see all the time already. You know how he's feeling. You know what's all that. Remember, they see humans as one giant millipede. So if you could push it all together and feel that, if you could see that giant millipede all at once in one perfect moment, and I think that's what their books are doing.
And I guess that's why they have such an importance on focusing on the positive things, because they could feel the negative things too. So they really have to divert their attention to being like, only the pretty things we look at. We literally cut through that.
Which is kind of bad too.
Yeah. You need the negative things to learn.
You need the negative things. And I think if you only look at the pretty things, I think that could be a bad habit.
What do you think of how Billy panics at Wedding Versity when he finds PTSD, the four guards in Dresden? Oh, that's Maiduri Mustache. Awesome name. I think it's funny. What do you think of how Billy panics at the wedding anniversary when the band sings? PTSD, the four guards in Dresden?
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I was doing research about that. And what I found was that was like the culmination of Billy's grief from World War II. He hadn't really dealt with it. Think about it. Like, that's one of the few moments we see him living in the moment, where he's fully experiencing it again, and he, like, they go through it. It's one of the longest times they have us do that with him. And then for him to come to that moment where he's like, I don't know why this was happening, it's because he never dealt with the guilt I think he felt in the war. This is what I've read in research. People have been saying that. He never dealt with that. He never fully understood it or accepted it. So when he saw those four guards singing in such those tones, it brought him back to those moments where those feelings were felt, but he didn't know how to describe them yet. He wasn't old enough to break them down into what they actually meant. He was so young. I mean, if you talk about the innocence of these guys, the first time they saw a naked girl was when they accidentally walked in on them at the slaughterhouse. Like, to me, towards the end of the war, when they've seen things that you shouldn't see. They've seen candles that are made from the fat of people. Like, they've seen that, but they hadn't seen a naked girl. That just tells you about how lopsided their innocence is. They're extremely innocent, but they're not. So when he comes to that moment, it's him discovering that. And then he goes where? He goes straight upstairs and walks into the bathroom where the lights are out. And then he sees his son, the version of himself that's a child, you know, the person he's bringing to life, and he realizes he doesn't know him. He's the shell of a man, the utter shell of an adult. He's done all these things. They all just kind of came to him. He didn't really play an active role in his life. And to me, that was the biggest moment in the book where I was like, whoa. I imagined him in the bathroom looking at himself in the mirror with the son on the toilet next to him. And I imagined him just kind of coming to terms with the fact that, like, his whole life, he's taken a very passive role. He's been an uncle.
Yes. And then I think, you know, like you said about the child thing and him seeing the child version of himself and stuff like that. We were talking about this earlier about the whole theme of just the children's crusade of the book, of how, like, this man never made the choices that make you a man,
mm-hmm.
and make you an adult. And he's let things happen to him, kind of like you do when you're a kid. You get pushed around, you get told to do things. You don't really get to choose a lot of
you get dragged somewhere with your parents. Just like they got dragged to war.
Exactly. Things like that. And I think it's just a lot of the book is a reflection on just him and how he hasn't made the choice to do what it takes to, like, you know, develop as an adult, but at the same time, has he had the opportunity to? Because he was taken as a child and just put into the war. And then, you know, like you said earlier also, when children see their emotions very differently. And when you're forced to go to war or something, you know, you're forced probably to hide those emotions, and those could have just been embedded in him the whole time. I mean, they also talk about how at his optometrist office, he would just break out into tears crying.
He just weeps.
Would just weep, and nobody knew why. He didn't even know why. He just did it. And I think that's all residue from the war, residue from the past.
It's definitely post-traumatic
in the present. And that's another thing, is like the whole thing about how, you know, the way time works is that's all residue of the past, because you've lived all those moments already. Those moments are there and they're true, and they all lead up to who you are now. And I think that that's kind of, you know,
it's kind of
the
like
residue of the war. It's kind of like how the Trophon War.
No.
Dorians see time.
Mm-hmm.
Just through, like, the way we process time, I guess. With our memories and stuff. Because we have memories, whereas Trophon Dorians have time. They can just see time, where ours is in our memories. So
that's so interesting. Someone brought up Elliot Rosewater. I love that. If anyone reads other Vonnegut books, you'll know that there's God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater, where Elliot Rosewater is actually the main character. And in the book, they actually talk about the time he was in a hospital with some guy named Billy Pilgrim. And then also, Kilgore Trout is the main character of a book, Breakfast of Champions. If you like what he talks about with Kilgore Trout, the fiction writer, then you'll like Breakfast of Champions, because he talks about many more of the books that he writes. He's like, this book was about this. And I think each book is so insightful and so interesting. It's meant to talk about one thing. I can't make it time zone friendly for everyone. I was going to do this earlier, but then it wouldn't be good for people in Europe. I was going to do it later, then it wouldn't be people here. I'm sorry, guys. This works for my time. We'll do our best. We'll do our best to move it around, but we'll try to... okay. How long did it take me to read the book? Well, I was reading it slowly, trying to, like, take stuff in, make notes. I could read this book in, like, 2 days, a day, if I really wanted to. I took the whole time. I finished it yesterday. Okay, I am Delphine. Rosewater uses sci-fi to forget the war. Maybe Vonnegut does, too. There's a quote that I read, and the first time I read it, I was like, that is interesting. I just need to find it. So Diego wants to keep talking. Okay. So this is when, I'm going to read something real quick. It's when Rosewater and Billy are talking, and Billy's talking about Elliot Rosewater in the hospital. Rosewater was twice as smart as Billy, but he and Billy were dealing with similar crises in similar ways. They both had found life meaningless, partly because of what they'd seen in the war. Rosewater, for instance, had shot a 14-year-old fireman, mistaking him for a German soldier, so it goes. And Billy had seen the greatest massacre in European history, which was the firebombing of Dresden, so it goes. So they were trying to reinvent themselves and their universe. Science fiction was a big help.
Yeah, so
my note I wrote there... Vonnegut? Question mark? You were going to say
that? Yeah, I was going to say that, you know, I think that that moment where they say that they were trying to reinvent the universe around them, I think that's kind of what Billy Pilgrim's whole thing with the Tremalfadorians is that he's trying to make an excuse and make sense of the universe that he was put in and say, look, no, it's already set. Like, this is already going to happen. Like, I don't have any decision in this. That goes with his actions during the war, period, just going to war and seeing those atrocities and saying, I don't have a decision in this. Like, this wasn't my choice. This is what was meant to happen. That's the way the moment was structured, is that this was meant to be like this. So he tries to almost take the blame and the guilt off of himself, off of his own shoulders, and put it just on time, on humanity. So I think that's what this book is really trying to do, is it's Billy trying to make sense of this world that he was placed into, this war, this marriage to Valencia so he could have money. All this, things that he doesn't really care about, are all part of the system, part of the universe that he is. He's from the United States and all this stuff where it's the good thing to make money, to have a family, to have a great job, to be connected, to be an American serving in war, to be a war hero. All these kind of things are great things, but things that Billy doesn't really care much about or want any of. So I think he's really trying to, he creates this whole Tremalfadorian thing to make sense of the world that he inhabits currently, to try and take himself out of it, take the blame off of his shoulders, and, you know, elude what is already, what is his life.
Damn.
Yeah.
Diego just dropped some serious wisdom there. Blew my mind. So, but yeah, I think that's actually absolutely what that is. It's his attempt to reconcile with what he's seen and what he's done. So he puts it in the structure of it, like, I couldn't change it anyway.
Exactly. Like,
even if I wanted to, I couldn't change it.
The moment was structured. This is how it's supposed to happen. I can't make a decision in this. And I think that's also why he doesn't, why he's so indecisive. Because he doesn't want any part of it. He doesn't want to say yes or no, because he doesn't want to be the guy who says no to the war, but he also doesn't want to be the murderer in war and say yes, like, I'm gung-ho, I want to go kill people. Like, no. So he's fine being stuck in between.
But he really had
unstuck in time.
He really had no choice. Like, he couldn't take a choice. In those days, you couldn't be a not-patriot and not fight in a war.
And that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. He's just like, yeah, wow. Wow. We can end the book discussion now. That was awesome. right? Everyone else is on my page. Diego's been killing it. He's been taking a lot of really good classes. So.
This is my first time reading the book.
First time reader, too.
That was good. That was
really interesting, good. Right? Yeah, you have to read it again in like 5 years, and it kind of...
Yeah, it reshapes me.
It'll reshape a lot of things.
Like, as your life goes on. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to talk about one other important passage.
Exactly. Do something. That's what I hated about the book, too. I didn't like Billy Pilgrim. I was like, do something. Sorry.
I think the most likable character I've liked so far is Derby. Edgar Derby. The poor old guy that got killed.
Yeah.
He had his heart in the right place. He wanted to do the best. He was a little older. Like, he was. He's actually, I think, the best character in the book in terms of, like, someone that you could, like, respect.
I think he's the most model citizen within the universe that Billy Pilgrim inhabits, right? Like, in the sense that
that's
he's
why
the person
it's so...
who's muscular, handsome, distinguished, older, actually loves his wife. He's writing letters in his head. You know, he stood up against the Nazi.
For America.
For America, and said the values that America carries, blah, blah, blah.
And that's why
stuff.
The irony is so great.
Is
like
that
it says
he
in the first
dies.
Chapter.
Yeah.
It's that he gets killed. He doesn't die. He gets shot by trial for stealing a teapot in a completely destroyed, like, that's how, like, messed up that was. Yeah. It was like, nothing is here. This guy just picks up a teapot, and now everyone's...
Exactly. And imagine
and the war was over.
Billy, at being so young and seeing a man that...
He is the personification of irony.
Exactly.
He's the personification
exactly.
of irony.
And imagine trying to make sense of this world that the most model, best man that... is part of your crew that you have seen through this war.
That seemed to have it figured out.
Just gets killed for stealing a teapot.
Was like, really stealing at that point?
That is such a hard thing to comprehend. So, like, you know, I mean, war's terrible. Like, you know, I don't know.
We're going to keep moving through the book, and I'm just going to bring up passages and quotes, and we're going to go through there, because I think as far as book discussion, we've gotten a lot. And I feel like we haven't talked to you guys enough. We've kind of been talking, which is great. But now let's see. Yeah, poor teapot, poor guy. Exactly. Yeah, Diego's killing it. I agree. Yeah. Derby romanticizes the war more because he's older. Well, I think he sees. I think he just knows what the, like, he's older, so he experienced the world before the war, and he doesn't want it. He really sees the threat of what's coming.
Exactly.
The threat of Nazism. He can. He's at a place where he can understand the impacts it would have on different levels of life, and not just like him. He's dying. Those kids that he's fighting with, they're the ones that'll have to really deal with it.
The kids who had never seen a naked woman.
The kids who'd never seen a naked woman.
The young child.
It blew my mind. That part was so impactful. I want to read the part, but I passed it, so it's not a big deal. But the Englishman came into the hospital to check on Billy. He was an infantry colonel and captured at Dunkirk. It was he who had given Billy the morphine. How's the patient? He asked Derby. Dead to the world. But not actually dead, no. How nice to feel nothing and still get credit, full credit for being alive. To me, that hit me. How many freaking memes do you see on Instagram? Don't feel anything anymore. I have no feelings. Me pretending I have no feelings and actually having feelings. Like, to me, that's the same thing. Some people want to have, they want to pretend like they feel nothing and then still get full credit for being alive. That pisses me off. Like, when I read that, I was like, that perfectly makes sense in our generation. Like, no, you don't get credit for being alive if you're going to pretend like you don't feel things. Feeling things is being alive. I don't know. To me, that was like a big quote. What do you guys think? Favorite quote is when Derby stands up to the Nazi people before the narration says, "One of the main effects of war, after all, is that people are discouraged from being characters."
That's true.
Well, that's the military, too. You can't have a character in the military. It depends on uniformity. It's very structured that way. He becomes more and more desensitized by death, just like today's culture versus 1969.
Interesting. I think... what was I going to say?
What's my opinion of Weary? I didn't like him either. I thought he tried too hard. I thought he was doing too much. Weary was the guy that eventually died because of gangrene in his feet, that said he wanted to kill Billy Pilgrim, the one that was dragging him, the one that was beating him, the one that made the Three Musketeers in his head.
Yeah, yeah.
I hated it. As a person, I would hate him. I think if Diego and I were on that, we would be the two scouts that would ditch Billy and Weary and then go die somewhere else. We'd be the guys and like, we don't want to hang out with the guy that doesn't want to survive, and we don't want to hang out with the guy who thinks he's like...
Who thinks killing is cool.
Who thinks killing is cool, and who thinks this is like a game, and who thinks that he's some sort of like god in this world. You know? He was like, I'm the leader of the Three Musketeers, this disillusioned man. I would not want to hang out with him.
I mean, it's interesting that he died of gangrene. When you like rot on the inside.
You rot on the inside and it comes and
it's like an infection.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that kind of also personifies? No, I think it kind of is what Weary is to society too. The love of war is a gangrene that is going to rot us from the inside if we continue to push war and make war something that we, what's it called? The whole time
we romanticize.
It will, in the end, kill us from the inside out. That war will be the end of us if we continue to go to war. The end of us, all of us, like people, humans.
I mean, think about all the movies we have right now.
I think it's just so opposite, and I think that's just very interesting that he died of something that rots from the inside. And I think that's what happens if you make war your, you know, the foundation of your belief. And that's, I kind of like they think that's what he did.
No, that's what you mean. Him and his father were huge collectors, and they had all torture devices.
Like, exactly. So, you know, he literally rotted from his feet up, and dying from gangrene like that is terribly painful and disgusting. You're literally rotting from the inside, and you can feel your body, like the infection moves through your body and everything. So he also kind of tortured himself to death in the end. So like I think it's just interesting that that's the way he ended up.
And it's something you can't, like, the only way to fix it is to cut it off.
Exactly. So,
it's like his blood gutter. The only way to fix it is to end it completely. There's no way to stop it from bleeding.
Exactly. So, like, I thought that was just very interesting that that's the way that character died. I think it was purposeful. I think everything in this book The reason why this book is so great is because everything in this book carries meaning, it has a purpose, and it's there for a reason, or else it wouldn't be there. And I think that's the best thing of every piece of art.
He thought he was the John Wayne.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then he ended up just dying by his own accord, too. I mean, he died. He ended up killing himself, technically. His body ate himself, and he died. So it's incredible.
And all that was left were the children, the Children's Crusade.
I like that question. Important question. Billy died on February 13th, 1976, exactly 31 years after the bombing, on February 13th, 1945. Does this have meaning?
Well, I think it makes it circular. So it goes. You know, I think it starts where it ends. It ends where it starts. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think that was very, that was definitely on purpose. Yeah, Diego's, that's why I like having him along. Diego's very good at literary analysis, very good at, you know, he's a very good writer himself. So Diego's very good at that. And hopefully one day soon we'll have one of Diego's books to talk about. So tell me the secret so I can take it back to Earth and save us all. How can a planet live in peace? That's a very good quote.
I think the answer to that was that you can't, right? That you have to look at the good things, not the bad things.
Yep.
And that's again, like, I think.
Well, I think it's that, like, not, that they don't even have the answer.
That in itself is a choice, right? And like, I think that Billy Pilgrim, I think the only choice he made in his life, really, was to like keep looking back and looking back at a lot of bad points.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think he tried to find like. The balance in his life of good and bad, and he would go back to good things and bad things. But I think that's the point. You're always going to have good and bad things. Your life's not going to be great all the time. And like, you need to kind of, I don't know, be able to look back on more of the good things and see that life is filled with both sides.
It's a balance.
And it's about what side you pick to look at.
Mm-hmm. What is your opinion of Valencia? I felt so bad. She was such a loving woman.
Yeah.
Like, she's really a character you feel for.
She died because she was so worried about Billy.
And I think that was... I think also there's some guilt where Billy feels like, although he, like, chose to marry her, I don't think he felt like he deserved someone as loving as her.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he adorned her with all these things. You know, he did treat her well. But she loved him. Like... That was such a beautiful... I mean, to me, I saw that moment of her in the car trying to get there, and then, you know what I mean? To me, when I read this book, I saw the movie in my head of what was happening, and for me, that was a very powerful moment. Mm-hmm. There's one thing I pulled... I'm going through, pulling up passages, and that's what we're talking about. How does the universe end, said Billy. We blow it up, experimenting with new fuels for our flying saucers. Trothmadorian test pilot presses the starter button, and the whole universe disappears. So it goes. If you know this, said Billy, isn't there some way you can prevent it? Can't you keep the pilot from pressing the button? He has always pressed it, and he always will. The moment is structured that way. We always let him, and we always will. I don't know why. I want to talk about that. Yeah, we're top live. Oh, not anymore.
I don't know. I think that again is like that deterrence of blame of anything. You know, even the Tremalfadorans don't want to say that, yeah, it's like completely our fault. It's like, no, sorry, that's just the way time has its structure. It's like, sorry, no, we didn't wreck the universe. Time did, because time structured it that way.
Yeah, that guy's always going to push that button. If not him, someone else. You know, we can't deal with it. But I think that also allows them to continue fighting terrible wars and to continue doing that with no repercussions whatsoever. It's not their own decision. Like you're saying, they're letting time completely take the blame for everything. Which I think is something that Vonnegut's actually calling out. You know, when someone says, you should read an anti-glacier book anyway. Does Vonnegut feel like there is no point? Because he goes, I believed him too. I believe that too. There'll always be wars and there'll always be glaciers. But I think that's also like ironically calling out the point of view that can't change the world. The point of view that's accepted as it is. Oh, they're peace. There's a belief in political science that I think it's the realists. They believe that peace is only the time in between war. Yeah. It's not a time to be sought after. It's a time that's just happening. Like right now, we're in peace, although we're not. I love this book, Listless Playthings. What do you think about Mary O'Hare?
Which one's that?
Bernard V. O'Hare's wife.
Who's Bernard V.
O'Hare? The good old friend that he went in the first chapter to drink and talk about the war. And she had two kids.
I think she is the sentiment of anyone who knows war is bad.
Yeah.
Is that they think people who go to war are bad.
And it's funny, because at one point he says, like, the people who hated war the most are the people who really fought. And I think he's making a parallel there to saying not only the soldiers fight, the women back home who lost their sons and their husbands, who kept the world moving, those women fought just as hard and lost just as much, if not more. You know, I don't know, I think that was like a cool thing, because that's something people don't think about. Military families do sacrifice a lot. For me, that was a moment. I was like, yeah, hell yeah. We talked about that. Yep. I love when Vonnegut brings himself in. And it's like, an American nearbilly wailed that he excreted everything but his brains. A moment later, he goes, there they go. There they go. He meant his brains. That was I. That was me. That was the author of this book. I love that, because then that's bringing in a moment where you're like, okay, so he's tying this to truth. This really happened now. So Billy did, some guy did walk in on him when he was screaming that. Maybe that's the guy he based Billy Pilgrim off of, you know? Who knows if that guy made it, so it goes. But who knows, you know, it's so cool. Also, I love that he constantly nestles people like spoons. Billy and Valencia went to sleep nestled like spoons. There they were sitting in the thing, nestled like spoons. The two dead men over there nestled like spoons. People are spoons, I guess.
Have we talked about So Goes yet? Like, about specifically...
No, we haven't. We talked about it in the first live, but we haven't talked about it. We haven't brought it up again yet. Should we bring up So It Goes yet? Or should we do it at the end?
How long is
it? Oh, sorry. We have about... We have to go soon.
I feel like I'm always that guy who's like, yo, we gotta go, but...
Oh, we only have 5 minutes left anyway. Let's...
The AD gotta keep moving.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Relevant to today... America's the wealthiest nation, but it hates the poor. That whole passage that was read by the monograph written by that American living in Germany, saying like the American soldier's the way it is because of that, oof, blew my mind. But we will talk about this real quick. So it goes. Diego wanted to talk about it because we had a discussion, but Diego had a really interesting insight. You want to talk about the syrup? Wait, why the syrup? That's interesting. Tell me what you want to say. That's really cool. You know what? Anything you guys want to talk about? Oh, crap. And I have to wrap it up, too. So I'm going to start wrapping it up. I'm sorry, guys. We had a great discussion, I'd say. We had a good talk about this book. And now we can talk about other books and other things. So, the syrup was so important. With the spooning it. Huh. If you're so smart, why aren't you rich? That's something that I thought was interesting. I was like, that's true. Why does intelligence always... But some of the smartest people I know aren't wealthy at all. I think that's people that have bought into that system. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's people that like buy into the system that the people at the top are winning. You have to be smart to be up here. You have to be this to be up here. You guys just aren't there yet. No, I think they just do sleazy things sometimes. Sometimes they do it truthful and right, and they earned it. But, okay. So as you guys know... Thank you for joining. Thank you for reading the first book, Slaughterhouse-Five. I had a great time. I did notice the Drain the Swamp reference. I had a great time reading this with you guys. I hope you guys enjoy it. I hope you guys had a great time. I hope you guys continue to read with us, and I hope you're ready for the next book. As you guys know, the next book is To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee. I am going to come out over the weekend. And I'm going to post a picture of the book. I'm going to post the exact dates that you need to have things read by. I'm going to post it all over the weekend. Don't tweet me about it. Like, you haven't posted it yet. I will post it. I promise. Going to do it later. Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee. The next live is going to be next Saturday, same time, noon. And I will release how long and where we're supposed to have read to by then. Also, I'm going to announce the next book. November.
November? Knowing me, I have no idea what books you have either on the list.
All right. The next book in November is going to be... I have the list. Hey! All right, is everyone still there?
Looks like it's just 3 or 2.
Okay, cool. My phone's going to die. But the next book is going to be 1984 by George Orwell.
After
To Kill a Mockingbird. Does everyone hear me? Yes. Everyone hears me. Still here. Awesome. Next book. 1984 by George Orwell. So you guys have a month to buy it. I'm pretty sure you can find the PDFs online. We can all talk about it. We can figure it out. Tweet at me like you have been if you find PDFs in different languages too. That's been super helpful. I'll tweet those out so people that speak the same languages, you can read it as well. Remember, you can read in whatever language you want. So, yeah, a lot of us already own it. I've never read it. I bought it a month ago to read it, and now it's on the list. So, the next two books, we're starting To Kill a Mockingbird. Start reading it Monday. You can start this weekend if you want. I will come out over the weekend with the amount of time, or with how far you're supposed to read. The next one...
These hearts hitting me in the face.
The next book will be 1984 by George Orwell, and then there is a book after that for December, but we will not tell you as of yet.
Top Live. We made Top Live.
Hey, yeah. Top Live. Well, anytime we go over 300, we get Top Live, and then we dip under it. Goes back down. So, George Orwell. If you just type in 1984 book on Google, guarantee you it'll pop up. 100% guarantee you it'll pop up. Actually, it'll pop up before you finish typing.
Jay,
what's up? All right. So, guys, thank you so much. Everyone say thank you to Diego for joining and giving us amazing insight.
Keep reading.
Exactly. I'm excited to start To Kill a Mockingbird with you. Keep sending me your questions about Slaughterhouse-5. Maybe I'll answer a few. Any ones we didn't talk about? Dude, let's totally go eat. Until next time, guys, keep reading. And we read our first book! Sorry, it's so exciting. We did it. We have a book club, guys. We did it. I can't wait to read the next one. Have a great time. Have a great day. Have fun this weekend. Tell your parents that you love them. And... do something you haven't done before this weekend. Like, go somewhere, go sit in a park, I don't know. Challenge yourself. And, try to become unstuck in time a little bit. See what that feels like. Have a good day, guys. I'll see you later. Until next time.